The first step in creating a PIUnit or PIUnit batch is to either use the batch generator plugin or the module database editor. Both are plugins found in the PI SMT or system management tools. I've got that open here, and we'll go under operation first, and we'll look at the way to do this in the module database. I will expand my server, and I'm going to create a sample module just called sample batch module. And if I create this just as a standard module, it retains the little block M over the cube diagram indicating that this is a module in the module database. But if I were to have gone and edited that and I were to see there is a checkbox that says is PIUnit, and if we were to check that, that is setting the unit batch indicator in the PI system. And you'll notice that when we do click that, we do get a little different icon here. It looks like a bluish tank with some lines coming in and out of it. So there's you can set it this way if you want. I'm going to edit this again and take the isPIUnit away and turn it back to a regular module. We can also accomplish this if we go to the batch generator plugin. You'll see there are two views here, registered units, which there are none yet on this server, and module database view, which essentially shows us the same tree that we saw in the module database editor. If I expand this out and I find my sample batch module, I can right click and say convert to PIUnit. That is another way to set that flag. If we were to go back into the module database editor, we would see that that is PIUnit flag is set. So if you're ever wondering what is PIUnit means, that means it's a PIUnit for the PI batch generator. The main consideration and one of the trickiest parts of unit batches is the active point, or sometimes referred to as the trigger for the unit batch. In this case, we have the setup in the PI batch generator section. Select your batch module and the unit batches tab, and you will see all these settings displayed for you here. The trigger or active point configuration is going to require you to enter a tag name into the field, or you can use the ellipsis button to do a tag search and choose a tag. And you'll be asked to choose pulse or step behavior, and if it's stepped, you'll be asked whether you want to include the zeroth state in the transition mechanism. Another word for that is to make it a continuous stepped behavior. We'll see an example of that in a moment. If you happen to choose an active point that's a string type tag, we will ask you to indicate what the values are here, including that include the zeroth state or the start or stop of a batch. That way we know when to start and stop the batch on a string value, because there isn't a simple integer or digital change behavior. One of the things that's really key to active points and trigger tags is make sure your exception specifications are set correctly. You want to make sure you pick up every state change on these tags. You don't want any state change or any meaningful alteration to be filtered out. So in many cases, people will turn the exception reporting either very low or off for trigger tags. So make sure you examine how your exception and compression processes are for your trigger tags. The compression process is important in the instance where your batch generator should for some reason stop running, and you need to go back in time and recreate your unit batches. For that to occur, you cannot have exception filtering out your data for your triggers. So let's look at the active point behavior and in a step or pulse mode. And we'll take the step first. In a step configuration, every state change is considered an end or a start, end of the current batch and start of the next batch. So in our case here, we have our first state, which is 0. We will start a unit batch at that point. And then if we select step in the methodology for our active point behavior, every state change will stop the current or end the current unit batch and start a new one. And then when we go back to the 0 point, we will simply end the current batch. We will not start another one unless you have continuous mode selected. In that case, that will start a new unit batch as well. Now, we also have something called a pulse behavior, and a pulse behavior essentially pays attention to the zeroth or first initial state that the tag is in. It ignores all state changes while that tag is, while the unit batch is running, or whatever state changes occur are ignored until that state change comes back to the initial value, and then we end that unit batch. So the big difference between the step and the pulse behavior is that pulse only pays attention to the initial state. When the trigger or active point leaves that initial state, we start the unit batch, and when it returns to that state, we end the unit batch. Whereas in a step configuration, every change is significant and every change will end the current unit batch and start a new unit batch. Aside from the active point or trigger tag, there is one piece of information that is absolutely required for each unit batch, and that is a unit batch ID. This is a number or a string that makes this particular run unique from the one previous or the one next. If the batch ID does not increment or change between your unit batch runs, the PIBatch generator will assume it's all part of the same run and it will merge them. So you need to be cognizant that you need to have that value change or be input or somehow be unique. We also have optionally product and procedure information that we can store. Some people refer to procedure name as the recipe. So what we do is we take all this information, we take the batch ID, the product, and the procedure or recipe, and we create tags for them. So we have a unit batch ID point, a product name point, and we have a procedure name point. And those are evaluated in one of three methodologies. We can either use the default setting, and whenever we detect a new batch event on the active point or a new trigger, we will evaluate all three of those tags, all three of the unit batch ID, product name, and procedure. Or you could program in a delay, and the evaluation delay gives you a configurable amount of time before between the trigger being active and the amount of time in seconds that we go and get that other information. So if for some reason your batch, your unit batch starts up and then somebody enters the information into tags, you can configure a delay during which time people can have the opportunity to enter that information. Or you can just say, read those tags at the end of each unit batch. And these are all set up in the batch generator plugin to the SMT. You can see that we have unit batch ID, procedure name, and product name, as well as an evaluation delay and evaluate at the end of each batch. If you leave the evaluation delay as 0 seconds and do not check evaluate at the end of batch, we will evaluate this information when the active point goes off or when the trigger goes off. Finally, in step two, we have some options for things like debugging messages and whatnot, and those are found at the bottom of the batch generator plugin with your batch module selected. The first one we have is recovery options, and this is an optional setting that defaults to all batch objects and a recovery time of 4 days. And what this is going to do is go back in time to the latest batch data that's been recorded, and it will try to rebuild or reconstruct all the batch information from the current time back to that point. And this is used in case for some reason your batch generator should stop or something trips it up, and your batch generator is not recording batches. It's not evaluating the active points for a certain period of time. So you can come back and up to 4 days later or whatever you configured this number to be, you can come back at that point in time and say, oh, my batch generator stopped. I need to rebuild my batches. This is one of the reasons why it's absolutely critical to look at your exception and compression settings for your trigger data, because if you have the exception and compression settings set too high, you could conceivably lose things throughout time that would be required to rebuild the batches. So make sure that you're seeing every transition change in your trigger tags and that you're recording all those to your disks, because you want to make sure you can recover. Now, you do have the option of not recovering anything. This will simply turn this functionality off. Or if you want to lighten the load, if you've got a lot of sub-batches, you can opt to recover only PIBatches and PIUnit batches. That lightens the load on the PIBatch generator and the PI server a little bit. The default is to recover all batch objects. We've also got something called merge consecutive, and merge consecutive says that if all the unit batch ID and other information is the same for two batches, just merge them together, assuming something got tripped when it wasn't supposed to. But by default, we have that to off, but you can turn that on. And then we have debug messages that are usually off unless something's not working right and you want more information written to the PI logs. You can turn that on by simply clicking the radio button.